Hello, everybody. It's Mark Oakley here again with another episode of From the Valley. And today we've got one of the key reasons I built this studio. I had this vision that I wanted to promote businesses, small businesses up and down the valley by the original vision was gangbusting my way into the shops. Like, hi, can I interview? And they're like, startled, you know. But Ali Verve?
Yeah, Vervaeke is my last name. But yes, Verve is the company name.
Has agreed to come in and talk about her cool products. You make soap.
Yes, soap and some other things as well.
But before we get to that, just tell me a little bit about yourself. Have you lived here your whole life?
No. So, yeah, good question. I fell in love with the East Coast when I was a little girl. Actually, do you know the movie Pete's Dragon?
Yeah.
You know?
The original.
Yes, the original. So, you know how they live in a lighthouse?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, I grew up in Ontario, unfortunately. And I remember thinking, I'm going to live in a lighthouse one day. And
do
I don't.
Okay.
<It's> like, unfortunately.
I hear it's a bit of, it's hard work, man. It's,
yeah,
they're
no,
not
I know.
Particularly, you know,
I
it
know.
Takes a little
long
bit of work
days.
To long insulate
days.
Them, right?
Yeah, yeah,
long days,
long,
long
nights.
nights.
No, I didn't. But I fell in love with the East Coast, and I knew pretty early on that I wanted to move out east to study. So I did that when I was 18 and kind of have been here since, off and on. My partner and I moved to China for 4 years and Korea for a year. So we're just coming back from that stint. So, we'd spend our summers here. My parents ended up moving here. You know, the classic story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's like one strong family member who sort of makes the leap and everyone kind of trickles
out. Yeah,
after,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. That's the goal also. Yeah. We're like slowly recruiting the other siblings. Anyway. And so here we are. We always wanted to come back. We knew that was sort of in the works, but, gotta go away and student debt and do all those things you need to do. So we're back and loving it.
Wow. 18 is a fairly young age to have a solid vision of where you want to go.
Yeah. You know, it is funny. Well, part of that was we would vacation in New Brunswick every year. Do you know Graminan Island?
Graminan. I used to live in New Brunswick.
Oh, did you?
I was seven. Six and seven, right?
Yeah.
Now.
It's kind of a little known place. It's pretty magical. It's very off the beaten path and very rustic. But we started going there, my mom and I, every summer when I was like 12 or 13. And so that's really what solidified the like living in the lighthouse dream. And then Nova Scotia was, you know, kind of in the same area. So I ended up here for school. But
so you just, you were camping or staying like a little?
We'd stay in a little cottage on the beach. And it was just such an amazing time. Yeah. And just very connected to the ocean there. And yeah.
That's really interesting. When I was a little kid, one of the things that we'd do is a regular summer holiday thing was go to PEI.
Yeah.
And it was the same thing. We'd rent like a little cabin, which was, there's sand everywhere. So you sort of walk up the beach and then walk across the sand and then there's your little house and you just stay there. It was, it was amazing.
It is amazing.
But it didn't make me want to move to PEI though.
No. Oh, really?
I wasn't aware of the world in that way. You know,
right.
It's you're like a little kid and you just sort of, you get out of the car and that's where you are.
That's right.
You know?
Yeah, it's true. I don't know what the pull was, honestly, because it's not like I grew up in Toronto or anything. I grew up in a really small town. Like, it only had an arena, a bank, and, like, a corner store, not even a grocery store.
Where did you grow up?
I'm
from Ontario.
So. Oh, okay. So, between Guelph and Hamilton.
Wow. Yeah, that's a stretch of nobody's land. Nobody would.
Very few.
You know what? Because people might be watching from there. And, you know, I do love Ontario.
Yeah, yeah. There's
bits
beautiful.
About it that are great.
Yeah,
but it's not the East Coast. And if there's salt in your blood, man.
I wouldn't go back. And again, it is a beautiful place and there's some great spots in Ontario. So I shouldn't hate on Ontario. But the pace of life is just not for me. And
So you were just in like a little teeny high school of like maybe 300 kids?
The high school, no. So we were bused in. So the high school was like a bit of an amalgamation of the smaller communities. And eventually our little town got subsumed. Is that a word? Got, you know, brought into Hamilton.
Okay.
So then we became Hamilton. But it's a little town called Carlisle. And it's just like a corner.
There is this... the Niagara Escarpment.
Yeah.
Have you visited
that? Yeah, yeah.
That's really interesting. That was one of my favorite geological features of the region.
That's right.
Did you go out there on like school trips and stuff and explore the caves?
I don't know if we did on school trips, but my mom was awesome about taking us out hiking.
Your mom sounds like my mom.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
She was really made a point to get us outdoors and like, you know, we'd go feed the birds and like hike to... Hamilton actually has a huge number of waterfalls. Little known fact. And it's because of the escarpment. They all, trickle down into the big valley there. So There's over, I think over 200 waterfalls to explore. Wow. So yeah, it was a cool place to grow up. I mean, it wasn't like I was lacking anything there, but there was just something here that...
You hit a certain age, especially when you're getting into your teens and early 20s, where small town isn't just, you're just like, you're not going, oh, this isn't for me. You're like, I hate this.
Yeah.
I am full of emotion and this is not who I'm supposed to be. And I despise you, right. Small town, you know? And so you make a jump, but, jumping to Nova Scotia, it's all, we're all about small towns, right? So.
Yeah. And I love small towns. I think it was just like, I didn't want to stay in that small town. And you know, it became sort of a sleepover town for Toronto commuting. So it wasn't like a small town.
Oh.
There's wonderful community there, I'm sure.
Sure.
But it just didn't. It changes
the character, man.
Yeah. Yeah. When people just kind of, they sleep there and, you know, they leave and spend their days elsewhere, right? It didn't really have that. It was a great place to grow up, though. It really was. It was, like, pretty special.
Did you have, like, scads of friends?
We, you know what? We just had the right amount of places to play. Like, we had these woods behind our house, and we had train tracks right behind the house.
Train tracks?
Yes.
When you're a kid. What is it about that?
Oh, man. I know. The trains are gone now. But they were active, and there would be, like, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 a day. And it was such a big part of my childhood, right? The sounds and visually, like, seeing the train, but we would put pennies on the train tracks and build forts around the tracks. Like, really dangerous stuff.
Oh, incredibly dangerous.
It was awesome, yeah.
I remember there was a train museum in New Brunswick, and when I was, like, 6, I was going to grow up to be an engineer.
Sure.
My dad's an engineer, an electrical engineer.
Okay, yeah.
But I didn't make the distinction, so I thought, he goes to work and he drives a train?
That's
so
amazing.
Cool, you know? So we go to this train museum, and it was like going to heaven, right?
Mm.
And they had all these sort of vintage working steam engines that would, cool. They'd sort of roll out and you could go on little rides around. You know, and one of the things they would do is, okay, we're going to crush pennies. And so we put pennies on the track and they would roll over it at like 5 kilometers an hour.
So
and it would just squish.
Yeah.
And so I had, I don't know where it is now, but my family was like, hey, we're going to do this on the main, you know, CP rail thing. So we laid out some pennies. And this thing blasts by at a million miles an hour.
Yeah.
The pennies are gone.
Yeah.
I imagine them just like flying off like little projectiles that could have killed us, right? But it wasn't quite the same.
Yeah.
But
you got to go search for them. We'd like put them.
Did you find them?
Oh, yeah, yeah. You'd just have to look around for a while. You know, and the little shine, the little glint would catch your eye. But that was just a fun place to grow up. I feel for kids these days, like there's just not a lot of wild places anymore where you're
they're tagged, you know,
especially
if they're carrying around cell phones, like they have to sort of call in and everyone's, it's a very, very different attitude now.
Yeah.
And how old are you? Do you mind me asking?
How old am I? I'm turning 33, so I'm 32 right now.
Oh, you're just a child.
just
a kid.
A baby.
That's why you look so, yeah.
Yeah, good, okay.
I'm 50. I turned 50 last year.
No, you're
year.
Not.
I know, but, you moved to Nova Scotia. Moved to Nova Scotia. You gain an extra 10 years, I think.
Perfect.
Is that
okay, good.
It works?
So I'm like
23.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Tons of time.
Nice. But when I was a kid in the '70s, oh my god, like parental supervision was just like, get outside. You're driving me nuts.
Yeah,
okay.
No, don't
supervise yourself.
That's
you know?
Right. Don't come back till supper.
But we had this. There was like a milkman.
Yeah.
Who actually?
Really? There was still.
Was he milkman? Maybe it must have been a mailman. It was some guy in a van who wore the little hat. And he looked like out of a cartoon. And one of the special things you could do is you could run behind his truck and say, hey, can we go for rides? Oh, sure, hop on. And he'd let you on the back of the truck. And you'd sit there with your little legs swinging. And there was like a hole in the bottom of the truck so you could drop like rocks through it. And he would just drive you around until you got bored and he'd hop out. See ya, kids. All right. And it was just like.
Oh, my God. That would never fly today.
Ever. You know, but that was like this Rockwellian beautiful. And that was just the community. Everyone looked out for everyone else.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was such a time.
And
you
probably spent so much time outside, right?
All the time outside.
Yeah,
you know?
I was like, you're so bored inside.
Yeah, there's only two channels on black and white TV.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah, no, I do feel like, and there's a lot of reasons why, but I do feel like kids kind of got robbed of that freedom to explore and
to play.
It's
a different world now.
It is different. It must be hard.
Well, I think it's like, kids don't have any reference points.
Yeah,
so if you toss them into the world, they're going to just like take all that energy and enthusiasm and build with what they have.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe it's robbed. It's different from what we had.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, it could just be when you love something or something very comfortable and familiar. Share it, right? Yeah, you would hope that other people would have that experience. But you're right, I'm sure there's opportunities now that we didn't have, right? That are probably great too. So
you know, it's I do think that keeping tablets and screens away from kids for as long as you can is probably a good move.
Yeah.
A really good move. Yeah. I've seen the effects with and without, right? And
yeah.
It's just you don't have kids yet, do you?
No.
Is that on the radar at all or?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I mean,
good for you though. That's like I have such fond memories of childhood, mm-hmm. and I never had kids, and I'm it's now like this daily sort of, you know, so when I see people who are sort of like thinking about it, like, oh, you know what, it's probably a good idea, you know, it's like, I mean, the choices I've made in life have been, I probably wouldn't be able to build a studio and work on comics my full time, and I love that, but I definitely see the value these days, and I bring it up constantly, so it's like, if you're going to have kids, it's so cool. Good for you.
Yeah, I think but it is good to have to question, you know, if why you want to and how it's going to look and to have those conversations, right? Because it's a huge thing and it's a stressful thing, or it can be, right?
Like, I have the ability to have a crazy project fail and I'm okay because I can get by on $30, you know? And but if you've got two kids and you've got all these responsibilities, that's not going to work, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah, it does. It changes things. But I think I'm from a family of four kids, and I just like grew up with the busyness of people coming and going and friends and events and, you know, sports.
Oh,
and it was just such a active home with people coming and going. So it's hard for me to imagine not having that in the future, you know, obviously like with our own kids, but it would be, there's just something like I'm really connected to with that sort of busy social like childhood.
Where do you live in the valley? Are you in Wolfville? Are you already out? Or there's like this town central, there's lots of people in.
Right.
When you get into the outskirts, it's like you got to watch out for coyotes.
yeah, we're not that far. So when we came back, we thought we might want to be in Wolfville, but you know, Wolfville is expensive and there's some downsides to living there.
Sure.
It's like the most awesome town for sure. But so we found a place in New Minas, which of all places, I didn't expect we'd end up there. You know, sort of easy to knock on New Minas for it being super commercial and
it's like
ugly.
Every town in North America, it's got a Walmart, it's got the big box stores, it's got three or four gas stations, and it's a business district, but it's just a small spot. When you get outside that, I mean, literally, I don't know why I was behind a Walmart, but I was. And I was just like pondering and going, you know, there's like, it's like this dividing line. It's like concrete and pavement and grippy box store. We go the other way, there's like, you know, you walk for 2 minutes and you're looking at eagles.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, human society hasn't dominated. We just think it has because we stay in our little bubbles.
Yeah.
I had a friend who was saying, no, man, I flew over it. He was in like a prop plane and he's just like, it's this endless green with these little gray lines.
Sure.
That's all it is. You know?
Yeah, it's true. And that's sort of what happened. We found this place. It had 2 acres. And we have old growth trees on the property. Like huge old trees, big pines. And we didn't expect to find that there. And it's just the end of a cul-de-sac. It's super quiet. It's away from you. You don't even hear the road. So that's where we ended up. And we love it. And it's sort of, it really is a perfect mix of like, kind of feeling tucked away in the woods, but also being convenient and close to things.
That's not bad.
Yeah, no, it's good. And not like, we're not the type of people that love shopping in most of those box stores. That's not, we don't even spend any time in New Minas proper, but just to have access to like, you know, just dropping the car off at the mechanic, which feels like it's every week, you know, it's like, it's right there. And Speedy Auto Glass is right there. All these things that you do kind of need, it just doesn't take away from your free time to be driving to do that stuff. So.
Right.
So it's nice,
It's interesting. Like an old town like Wolfville, it's built on a different sort of, game plan. Like, you have to be able to walk to work because nobody had a car.
Right.
And if you're not working as a fisherman, then you're either in a canning plant or it's, you know, the houses look more modern, but they kind of don't. That's like, they put up siding, but underneath that is a 200-year-old building.
Right.
Or a 100-year-old building, 150, whatever. But then when you get beyond that, you have these very modern structures. I'm guessing you live in like, you know, a recently built cul-de-sac?
Yeah, so it was built in the 70s.
Okay.
Which it feels like everything was built in the 70s, you know, like all those little subdivisions. And I was wondering, I'm not sure if that's, if it's accurate, but maybe it was because like the baby boomers were hitting the age when they were all looking for houses and there was just like wealth and prosperity. I don't know, but it feels like a lot of houses we were looking at when we were searching were all built in the 70s. I'm like, what was happening then?
It's all the houses I've lived in have been 70s, right? And yeah, it's, or you know, much older row houses that were from like the coal age, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
And but that's, and it depends on how close you are to the city core or the town center, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's like after the 70s they still built houses, but there was like a boom and they all look the same, don't they? They kind of have like the, you know, did you ever watch the Brady Bunch?
Oh man, like whatever, but a long time ago.
That sort of like, you know, ooh, that was modern aesthetic, you know, and that's kind of like, well, that's what they built, and it's still there. I have a lot of, I have a real fondness for. I ever use that the Google Street View thing?
Yeah, totally.
It's okay. It's, I don't know if it's a guilty pleasure, but it's, so this weird little time sink. You're going, oh, where did I grow up? And you drop the little man on the street, and you go, now you're looking at like, I found my old house that I was 6 years old in.
Isn't that neat? A long,
and it's nothing's changed. Right. It's everything's smaller. That's the other thing too.
Oh,
it's
interesting. Like, sometimes I feel like when I've done that, everything looks bigger. But I wonder if it's just because the trees have gotten bigger, or if I've gotten bigger.
Well, if you get bigger, it's kind of like, have you gone back to your old grade school ever? As an adult?
No. Well, maybe once in the last like 20 years.
That was, how did you, how did
it was, there's a lot of emotions there and like memories flood in and it's a lot, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I found it,
it's crazy.
I wasn't even that old. I don't even know, whatever. I was there for some reason and I was in my 20s, late 20s, early 30s, something like that. And the first thing I noticed is that I remember these hallways being like giant Death Star hallways because you're only like, you know, 4 feet or 2 feet tall or whatever.
Yeah.
Now I'm this big hulking guy and I'm having to duck under doorways. I'm like, what the, what happened? It's like the whole building shrunk, you know? But the memories, you're like, oh, it's Mrs. Such and Such's room. And it's like, you know?
Another thing that was funny about thinking back to that time in your life is like, I remember thinking teachers were all ancient. Like they were all so old. They're like my age, you know?
Oh my God.
30s, 40s. And, but when you're younger, you're just, I mean, your perceptions are all kind of.
A friend of mine, some of my old junior high, you know, classmates, I was in a very, very underpopulated junior high. We had like 300 kids, maybe. And that was like, you know, grade 7, 8, 9. So 100 kids per year. You knew everybody.
Sure.
The school had been built during a period when there was zillions of kids. There used to be like the whole soccer field was full of like portable classrooms.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was like baby boom time.
Yeah.
All that went away. We were like the X gen, the little weird dips. Having kids is stupid. That's just like, you're just lucky if you're here, right? And
you
so
made it.
There were all these empty lockers. You could have two lockers if you wanted, right?
Really?
It was pretty wild. But it was a really tight knit, really good group of people, right? And I haven't really, I was a weird kid. I had my strange friends that I was connected to. And I still am. But every now and then, I'll just sort of poke my nose in like a Facebook group. And they all still take care of each other.
Really?
They're still in the same community. And they just, they're growing old together. And one of them, a girl named Sheila, you know. It just boom, memory flash. Right?
Yeah.
She took one of our yearbooks and scanned every single page.
Wow.
And put it up on Facebook.
Wow.
And everyone was like, we have to look through this, right? And I remember our math teacher, there's a woman named Mrs. Schaefer, and or maybe it was a Miss Schaefer, I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, I remember her as being a big, tall, giant, ancient adult, you know? And I'm looking at her now going, oh my God, she looks like she might have been 23, 24, you know? Just a wee, you know?
I know.
And it's just like this pretty, and everyone was just like so bright and tiny.
I know. It's a special time. I think of it really fondly. And there's some things you feel like you just can't get back, you know, like your enthusiasm for some things and just the that excitement, that like can't sleep excitement. I do get that sometimes, actually.
It continues. Like this is something I think about and I feel like there's those waves of experience. Like you have like chapters. Like if someone's writing your life, they sort of do it in lumps. They don't put all the exciting stuff in one place.
Right.
They put exciting. And so what chapter are you in now?
Oh, is that the question for me?
Yeah.
Okay, what chapter am I'm in a very exciting chapter, actually. When I was overseas, I was teaching.
Talk about a chap. You were in China.
We're in China. So my partner's a PE teacher.
Okay.
So he's a trained PE teacher. I am not a trained teacher, but got lucky and fell into it and actually really dug in and enjoyed it and got into the theories and the pedagogy. You're a phys ed teacher. Not phys ed, sorry. No. I didn't say no. I was teaching English. Teaching PE. Anyway, that was a really awesome time, but I guess just being in Asia got a little hard on my soul, you know.
Like, Asia's big. Like, where,
yeah. We were in South Korea for a year, and then we spent 4 years in Beijing.
Oh, wow.
So we were in, like,
busy downtown. Land.
Yeah, and just, you know, the inability to get into the woods and to get into nature, you know, regularly. Like, we had great times going outside the city, and we'd hike on the wild part of the Great Wall, and we'd camp on the Great Wall and do lots of cool stuff. But those were, like, you know, a few times a year. So I really felt like I was missing a huge chunk of who I am, which is just like constantly being outdoors and connected to nature in some way. So that was one of the things that was really hard for me. And just over time, it became challenging for me to live there. Like, I felt like more and more kind of like,
oh, that's really interesting. You know? Like, did you, when you went to live in Beijing, was Beijing like a choice, or was it sort of like something that happened to you? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, it was something we were really excited about. But it was definitely like practical too, in the sense that we had big student debts to pay off and we wanted to save for a house back here. Mm. So it served that purpose, and we love exploring and adventuring. So it was sort of this dual, and also it was, you know, a great experience for Nate to keep building his resume and his experiences. That's my printer. So anyway, yeah, so we did have a great time, but yeah, slowly I felt like, you know, when you just feel like your soul's kind of being compressed a little bit and you feel like a little bit less and less of yourself over time.
Yeah.
But I feel like I'm coming out of that, and I'm like, I found this thing I absolutely love, and there's less stress in my life, and I'm outdoors every day, and so yeah, I feel like sometimes I can't sleep. I'm really excited.
Oh, that's so wonderful. It's good, yeah. And it's like, was it a difficult choice to make? I mean, were you on a... Did you say, okay, in 4 years we're gone? Or was it kind of like, how much more can we stand until we get ejected?
I mean, it's a good question. It started with, oh, we'll save enough in a year. We'll just do a year and we'll get out and we'll go somewhere else. You know, somewhere that's like not super polluted and not incredibly densely populated. But, you know, you often don't really think about the logistics of things. So it took longer than we expected to pay off our debt. And then
you paid it off, though.
And we did, yeah.
Good for you.
It was great. It was a big leg up.
Isn't it nice when it's like, oh, my God, the colors aren't, the numbers aren't red anymore.
Yeah.
It's this, and then you're saving. Oh, I didn't realize it could feel this good to have money. This is nice, you know.
It was a worthwhile. There were some sacrifices, and there was a lot of great times, too. Yeah. But it was so worthwhile, because that would be a big burden. And kind of what you're saying, like, about having kids and freedom and flexibility, like, I think because we did that, I have the flexibility and freedom to pursue something I love right now, not necessarily knowing exactly what the security of it is, right? Like, financially and where I'm going to be in a year and that sort of thing. But we can do it because we, you know, we're at, like...
Oh, it's... Remember so what it was nice. Like? I remember this, where it's like, you know, every month you're going, well, this is how much money I have. And half of it, or, you know, like $400 or $500 of it, just gets thrown down a black hole.
I know, right?
It's just gone. Yeah. You know? And it's not even serving anything. It's just balancing debts. Yeah. Just like, oh man, that's. And then you just kind of get used to it, or you ignore it, and it just grows. And it's just. And then when that black hole kind of goes, bloop, it's closed. You're like, this is so great. So now you've got this. Yeah.
Yeah, fresh start, right? Yeah. No, it's really nice. And I mean, I'm super lucky and privileged to have a partner who can, you know, support. He's teaching now. And so that gives me the chance to sort of like
talk about your business. I mean, I have all these little things I now.
Yeah.
I want to know more about China. Oh, I want to know what chapter you're in. But this is probably combining two of those questions. So this is the soap chapter.
Yeah, the soap chapter.
So how did you decide to, first of all, tell us what your business is. Give us the pitch.
Okay. So the pitch is,
can we get the long view so we can see all the products that she has?
Yeah. So, it started off as a soap company, but I always had plans to make it a natural soap and skincare company. So handcrafted skincare, artisanal soap. Mm. And it's actually does kind of go into the China talk a little bit, because it started in China.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So when we were there,
put some of these
little
out.
Background. Yeah.
I'm gonna let you hold your own stuff. I'm super excited about promoting little businesses,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, cool. Well, a little. I'll show it in a second. But
okay, sure.
When we were overseas, I would always bring natural soap back with us and be like, 10, 20 pounds of soap to last, because there it was really hard to find products that didn't have bleaching agents in them.
Oh, like having, you're bringing Western soap to China.
Yeah, I would go to like the Wolfville Fire Market. And I've always loved soap. So I would go to any fire market during the summer and then I would load up and bring it all back because, like I said, it was really hard to find like natural or gentle products there. And also, I'm not awesome at reading Chinese, believe it or not. So that was kind of how it started. And when I was there, I was thinking, man, this is getting kind of tiresome, bringing it back and forth. Like, why don't I just teach myself how to do it, you know? And so I did. And then I gave some to colleagues. We all lived in this apartment, right? On the school compound. And they're like, this is really great stuff. You know, I want some more. And then
You became the go-to.
Yeah, I was like, yeah, and everyone would be like,
I got a number.
You know? The third floor smells so good. Just like the elevator would open and you'd hear people like, oh, man. Because like, everything else kind of smelled like crap because it's China.
Oh, dear.
Sorry, that's not very nice. But, you know, like there's pollution.
A giant
like,
city of 30 million people.
Yeah,
how many people live in Beijing?
Oh, yeah. So it is, I think it's, there's a lot of undocumented numbers of people, but like, somewhere between 20 and 30 million is my understanding.
Yeah, that was my rough
guess.
Anyway,
Yeah. So anyway, that's how it started, and then it progressed to there was these mostly foreigner markets that would be in these sort of like dingy bars in the daytime.
They're kind of like speakeasies,
yeah,
but front, we need our farm market fix.
Yeah, exactly.
Where are we going to set up?
Yeah, it was like a lot of foreigners are like, oh man, I miss like homemade earrings and you know jewelry and cookies and all this stuff. So it was mostly foreign. Like organized and attended. And so the first time that would have been like February of 2016 or 2017, I guess, that I went to one of these and I didn't have a brand. I just had, you know, a few bars and they all had different names on them. So it was really confusing because people were like, what is your company? Is it Silver Fox? Or is it like these, I didn't know what I was doing. But it was great. And then from there, we do the markets. And then we had two retail stores that were selling my soap. So I would teach all day. And then I'd like run home and make soap all night in our tiny kitchen. That was like, it was not a lot bigger than like this area of this little garage space. It was so small. No stove. No oven. We had hot plates. Like that was what you cooked on.
Man.
So that was fine. Cause that's still what I used.
It sounds very eerily parallel to the drug industry, doesn't it?
There's a lot of mixing chemicals. And I mean, there's definitely some overlap there, but, so that's where it all started. And I loved it so much. And I knew that it wouldn't end in China. So it became the dream.
Were Chinese people interested in your product as
well? Yeah, good question. There was a couple we met, and she was Chinese, he was British, and they opened a zero waste store called the Bulk House, and I don't know if it's still there, but it was downtown, and they bought my bars like naked, unwrapped, and so they were selling to like primarily Chinese customers and people who were looking for, you know, alternatives to sort of the really, you know, toxic, definitely toxic, but just... not natural, not gentle products. Mm. So that was their thing. And then I was moving a lot of bars through them. So I was like working double time to try to keep up. So
wow, in Beijing with a commodity that nobody else has.
It was a good time. Yeah, because as I was leaving, there was a few soap makers and it was sort of one of those like,
Someone's like going, we're going to buy this and it goes into plastic bag immediately and it's like labeled and like, oh dear, that's going to be mass produced in a week.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, that's the thing. And there's so much copycat, like plagiarism or what's the word? There's another word for it. But
did you know there's a product called Lepin? Do you know what that is?
No.
Lepin? It's fake Lego.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, of course. And there's fake
like,
everything there.
Yeah. You know, it's you can get like baggies of like you go on like. You know, I was buying for a friend's kids for Christmas. They wanted Lego robots. Yeah. I go, whoa, if you go on eBay and you don't want the box, it's like $100 cheaper. It's like $40 out of $140.
Yeah.
Wait a sec. What? Lepin? What is this?
Yeah,
you know?
I know.
And the guy got busted because, like, where's Lego based out of Finland? Is it Finnish?
I feel like it's
Danish, you know? some Scandinavian country, and like, and it's like a major portion of their like their national GDP. Maybe it's saying too much, but it's like a, it's a point of pride. They're like, China, shut this guy down, man, and they just they wouldn't. And it was finally he was arrested. And all his little Lego bricks were seized. You know, like,
burned him down and then made Lego with them.
But what a thing, eh? You know?
Yeah, and it happens in every single industry. And it was like people even warned me, like, be careful, because if something sells well there, someone will take advantage of it and re, like, just tweak it ever so slightly and then resell it. But anyway, that didn't happen that I know of. Maybe there's a thriving.
Oh, I'm sure you can go on Amazon and find whatever you want. But the thing is, here's the thing. Finding everyone's kind of learned the nature of Chinese products. You know, it's like you still have to spend good money to get a good. There's some very good producers over there. Like, oh, that's where the best thing. Everything's made there. So there's, you know, ways of making it well, and there's ways of saving a dime, saving lots of dimes, saving all the dimes, and you get this little box with a thing in it. You know, it's like, and you got to pay for quality, and then the quality, there's not as much of that, and it's discerning buyers know, and the people who buy this kind of soap, they've had they don't need cheap soap, and they're gonna find you, right? So how's your business been doing since you moved back here?
Oh man, it's been great. It's just like
How long have you been at it?
So I launched my website, which I would call the official start, because that was the first chance people had to officially purchase it last February. So a year.
Oh, it's okay.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, a little anniversary. Yeah, it's been going great. Lots of great feedback and a lot of returning customers, which is always a really lovely thing. So I feel super grateful and very inspired. And I'm like just constantly dreaming up the next thing.
Do you do the markets personally?
No, so I haven't. You know, I launched it last year right before the pandemic hit. So
markets got weird.
Yeah, markets got really weird, and it didn't. There weren't a lot of opportunities to get into some. There was a few in the summer I could have.
Like Kelly's fought pretty hard to keep the Wolfville one going in some level of capacity.
That's
and it's pretty good.
So I think that.
But that's a waiting list, man.
And the other thing too is you want to respect the people that are already doing. You know, and
they've invested their time.
Yeah,
in
exactly.
Building a presence, you know,
So I wouldn't want to. I wouldn't want to, you know, be on their turf, because it's a lot of time to build your customers there, and also like from a market perspective, you want to offer a diversity of things. You don't want like too much of the same thing, right?
That's a big deal.
So but I am gonna look into doing some more markets this year, maybe like more sporadically. There's a lot of great summer ones and sort of pop-ups and stuff, so so shall I show you a little?
I'd love to see like I want to eat these. Can we get like the table cam here? Let's see, is this thing it's not. Okay, but this looks like a fruitcake.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, someone else said nougat.
Oh, you know, it smells like peppermint. And
yeah, good. Oh, you have a good nose.
Oh.
Anything else you pick up?
Oh, let's see here. Let's get right in. Let's see.
You got the peppermint. That is
that's the easiest
the strongest
one to get.
Yeah.
I'm getting some citrus out of there.
Okay.
Is there?
No.
Well, I'm getting that's
but
the end of my nose.
It can play.
That's the end of my nose. What about this one here?
Yeah.
Oh, you've got like a stamp. It's not like a sticker.
Yeah.
I got to tell you, I like that because, you know, when you get a bar home, peeling the sticker off and having to like go for the, and then you get soap under your finger. I don't like that.
Yeah, that's fair.
So having like a proper stamp makes it look super cool.
Cool. Thanks. Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, that one's gorgeous. They're like little works of art. I mean, you don't want to.
Thank you.
They almost look like candles, except.
Yeah. The artistic part is really what's a lot of fun for me. That plus like the essential oil blend, so creating a really neat aromatic experience.
Oh wow.
So they all have a different design, and I often will like sketch out different designs that I want to try to create. And what's fun and a little challenging is getting the colors right, or the colors as I imagine them in my head, you know, into real life, because I only use natural colorants, so I don't use any dyes where you get this guaranteed
color.
How did
you get this orange?
Yeah, so this is turmeric.
Oh, okay.
And then annatto seed, which is a little yellow seed that's actually often used in food products that have an orange color. Okay. So sometimes in cheeses or any other like things that have a nice bright orange, you might see annatto seed. So it's a plant, and what I do is it's ground and I put it in oil and I let it like infuse for a number of days at a kind of a lightly warm temperature. And so it extracts the color, and then I strain it off, and then that oil has the color in it.
Oh, neat.
Yeah. So, and this one's kale powder and French green clay.
Oh,
and
neat.
Charcoal. And the white, it's hard to get white. So titanium dioxide is like considered by some to be totally natural, and others might say like, oh, let's, you know, it depends on how you define natural, right? Because that's quite open to interpretation, but it is a safe, it's a food safe colorant. So that would be the one that's like the least natural.
You didn't
natural,
pick it yourself off a tree. You
had yeah,
to, someone had to
exactly.
get it deep out of the ground
yeah,
and
exactly.
oxidize it. And,
that's right. Yeah. yeah. So it would be the least, but it's still like a food grade. It's yeah. quite safe. Yeah. And then this one's alkanet. It's another root.
Purple's
and again,
hard, eh?
Yeah. Purple's
but
a
you've got
hard.
Like multiple shades of it. How did you do that?
Yeah. And so that's just mixing, you know, you're starting with the base, the dark color, and then adding a bit of a white base. So I separate the colors and okay. then add a bit of white to each layer as I pour it. So I pour them in these like loaf molds, right? Kind of mm-hmm. like a yeah. loaf of bread, like uh-huh. silicone mold. Yeah. And so you just sort of like layer it as you go and add white in each time.
Do they have different properties in terms of how they work with your skin, et cetera?
Yeah, not really. So
that's a whole other field.
Yeah,
right?
yeah, yeah. And I think, to be completely honest, like I think that sometimes soap makers, I think, overstate
oh,
what
sure.
soap can do for you. Like yeah. when I see claims about like
since forever, you know, yeah. like you know, this cream yeah. will make you 20 again.
Yeah. It'll take away really? Your cellulite. I'm like, what? How does that happen?
You yeah, know? Yeah, yeah.
So I'm careful. I mean, there it definitely can affect your skin if you have a bar that's like has harsh detergents and doesn't have nice skin.
Just not having arsenic in it is a giant
it's a
step,
good
you know,
step,
like
yeah.
you know, oh, this is lead based, you know, lead based soap. What?
Yeah, yeah. yeah that's good, yeah.
But I mean that's huge, because if you do look at the ingredient list of yeah. a cheap bar of soap, you're like, yeah. whoa, I'm sure this has been FDA approved, but
right.
you know,
it's yeah. And so I do really believe, like deeply, that where you can eliminate toxic or even like suspected carcinogens or suspected toxic products or ingredients, why not, right? Why wouldn't you? So I do really believe in that, but I also just personally think it's important not to overstate what, you know, a bar of soap will do, because it's a rinse off product, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's not a really great sales pitch for me, but it really is super moisturizing. So I've created a formula with ratios that it has really good lather, but it also is like kind of rich and creamy and moisturizing. Yeah. That's from shea butter.
Oh, okay.
And
see, already,
and olive oil.
Already your no corporate sort of soap manufacturers. Yeah. That's just gonna kill the bottom line. We don't use those products.
Right, right.
And so that's one of the nice things about being sort of, you know, a very small producer is yeah. that you can afford to use real butter versus vegetable oil.
Yeah,
you know,
that's
for instance,
right.
You know, like
yeah,
like
and a, you can use like unrefined. You have control over how you know how that thing is processed. Sorry, you don't have control over it, but you have control to choose. Which, you know, which form of these ingredients
oh,
you want to use.
Oh, I love that aspect. Like,
yeah.
I remember when I was a kid, way back, my mom was describing cheese.
Right.
And she's like, well, you know, if you have, like, giant company cheese, you know, I don't know if we call it corporate cheese. It just doesn't sound good. Corporate cheese.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's guaranteed to be the same every single time,
yeah.
which has its benefits.
Sure.
You know, that's great.
That's what you expect,
but
yeah.
she said, when I was a little girl, it was different every time.
Really?
And it comes from a batch and
yeah.
the weather
yeah.
would affect
yeah,
it because
it's
a growth. It's
That's
it's
right.
it's a fungus, right? And so
yeah.
depending on what spores are in the air
cool.
and sometimes it'd be so good and you'd savor it and you'd know that, you know, it's never going to happen again quite this way.
That's
and
right.
so just love it. And you yeah. feel really special. You're not sort of like numbed or like, this is just part of
the same
standard
That's
forever
true.
Experience, you know?
It's like a good vintage
yeah.
of wine.
You
it's
know?
Like, yeah.
You're just lathering up going, oh, this is the 78. I love my, well, hopefully not.
Yeah.
That's an old soap.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true, eh? Because some seasons are good for wine growers and some are not. And so you have like the same grapes can taste different in two
oh, yeah.
different seasons. So, and you know, it's kind of the same. I have really specific recipes that I follow like by percentage. So that I do strive for as much consistency as possible, because people do want, they love something, they want to know they're going to get at least somewhat similar, right? Oh, man,
I used to sell at farmer's markets, and I was, like, selling comics.
Okay,
but everyone else looked like they're having a lot of fun selling food stuff. So I was like, and I get, like, this crazy idea. Like, one year, I was like, I'm going to make chocolates. Christmas is coming up.
Cool.
And I didn't know how to, like, how do they get the soft part of the chocolate inside around it? Is there a way? And I researched, oh, that looks, I could do that.
Yeah.
And so I tried to go, these are so good. Yeah. Everyone should have these. And so I just made chocolates.
Cool.
And they were wonderful. But this one year, I said, I'm going to make spiced apple cider. Because that's a great thing. Mm-hmm. You come in out of the cold. And I'll just sell those. That. And so I got pretty good at doing that. People, oh, we like your cider. We like that experience. But then it became, I tend to be sort of like a sparking idea. That's where the enthusiasm is. And then if it becomes like a grind, you're like, oh, my God. I feel like cider. I almost poisoned Wolfville one time. I put in like, you know, cloves.
Yeah.
And they're, that's a great little flavor.
Sure.
And one time I was mixing it up early in the morning because, oh my God, it's 4:30 and you have to make it that morning, you know.
Fresh, yeah.
And I scooped in way too many cloves. And people were complaining, like, my tongue's going numb. I was like, is that a bad... And Ariel was like, my friend's like, Mark, that's, you can stop hearts with that shit. And I was like, oh my God. Like, stop drinking. Pour an extra water. Oh, so sorry. Oh, then I stopped.
Oh, no.
There's a real responsibility there.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Especially with consumables, for sure. Like, oh my God.
That was before food safety got involved in the markets and sort of shut a few people down.
Sure.
And I was probably, I wasn't doing it at that point, but that's the kind of person you don't want.
Me. No.
Stick to your comics, Mark. Yeah.
That's funny. That's a good story. This one actually kind of smells a bit cider-like. It has a clove on top.
Okay.
So, what can you pick
out? Oh, I'm not going to be able to name stuff.
That's okay.
It smells beautiful, though.
That one's a blend of orange oil, clove, cinnamon.
Orange oil?
Yeah. So it's sort of got those,
cinnamon.
Like, wintry.
I picked that up.
Yeah. Kind of those.
It has. It actually. It's got. It reminds me of spiced. You know. Apple cider.
It's actually. I called it spiced orange. It's called the Traveler because those spices, those like exotic kind of Chinese and Indian spices, and it reminds me of traveling. So that's why I called it the Traveler. So they each have a name that's kind of based on a person or a job, but like, for example, this one is like this one's the Curator. I didn't put the packaging on all of them because I want to show you, but they all have packaging like this.
Oh, that smells great. Eh?
Yeah, that one's three types of
mint.
You like that one?
I love that one. This is great packaging.
All right. That one's for you then.
Oh, thank you so much. That's
you keep that one.
All right.
So yeah, that's the packaging. And actually the packaging came to be because so the market in China, when I was selling at these markets, the bars were, they did have a little label on them.
You lifted up a little bit. We're in the camera.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Like that. Can you see?
There we go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. So I noticed that people would pick up the bar and then smell it and, oh, it's really nice. And then they'd put it down and then they'd kind of like do this with their fingers.
Yeah.
Try to get the little soap pieces off. And that makes sense, you know, because it is kind of a unique texture. So when I designed the box, I do the designs, I wanted it so that someone could pick it up, smell it, experience it, kind of see it, at least a little cutout of it. But not have to touch it because there's just, I don't know.
That's so smart, you know? That's
it was just something I learned from watching people, right? And like them interacting with my product. I just got to see, to learn it that way. So that was kind of neat. So I have these paper packages. I have a sticker that goes on them, but I'm going to move to have the box printed soon so there's no stickers, so then it could be like fully recyclable. You wouldn't have to take the sticker off.
There's a sticker on here? I don't see a sticker.
Yeah, there is. Yeah, it's right. It's just this.
Oh,
just
it's the back piece.
Yeah,
okay, yeah,
just the label.
And that's, is that like a, you know, up till 3 a.m. with a movie on the background and you're stickering
slow,
a thousand?
Yeah. But when you're starting out, it's cheaper to do it that way, but in the long run, it's actually better to
When you print your first, well, I mean, the boxes are printed.
Yeah, the boxes are printed.
They're there's like a
little embossed.
Packaging is fun. To design. Tell me about how that came together. Because you're going, how do you make a box?
Right.
That's your first question.
Yeah.
And then the next week you're like, oh God.
I know. It's like, a lot of pieces.
Did you have someone do it for you?
So the boxes, I obviously didn't print the box myself, but I did design it myself. And based on pretty much just, like I said, like wanting to be able to show some of the design, because I think the design is what is unique about my soap, is that it is, there are little, bits of art, I guess. And then, I just
Did you make little mock-ups?
I did, and
figure out how to fold them?
Or? Yeah, I remember, like, it was summertime, and in the night, I'd be sitting downstairs, like, cutting it and layering it, and then trying to get the stamp. You know, I was ordering the stamp, right? So I was trying to get the stamp size right, that it would be fit into. So yeah, it was a lot of playing around, and then, but from there, you can just send it off to someone who actually, you know, knows what they're doing, and then they printed the boxes. But
how much of that? This stuff really fascinates me. I hope it's not too nitty gritty for our viewers,
that's
but.
Okay.
So you have like a folded out thing or it's like a little mock-up.
Yeah.
Where do you go in Nova Scotia, or did you mail it, or how did you reach out to find
someone? That was a little tricky. I found a company in Toronto that prints the boxes. I've since found a guy who seems super cool. I'm really excited to work with him. He's in Windsor. So when I run out of these, I'm going to do the same thing, but have him print them.
I've really noticed that Nova Scotia has, you know, there's one person who does a particular thing.
Yeah.
And if they don't do it well, and there's no competition, it's like sometimes you get a really, really excellent craftsperson or someone who runs a good business. But I find I send a lot of business to Ontario just because there's like 40 people to choose from. They're all like, they have the capital. And the way Dan Sparkman described it, he was like, man, in Toronto, you know, how do you describe it? He said, I know a guy who bought like a container ship's vest, like one of those huge things that goes on the back of a train or a truck. And it was full of like ugly sweaters, you know. And he's like, yeah, I just bought that because it's like a novelty thing. He says, you can't sell those here. But in Toronto, it's like you just hold out a net and catch money. He'd rent something like a little shop space for 2 weeks around Christmas and just put up, you know, ugly sweaters on tables, and they all sell.
Wow.
Just because it's like there's 4 million people that are just flowing past.
Right.
So it's like a very different kind of environment. You can try different things.
Yeah.
And consequently, you've got a company that's like, we can afford a $4 million you know, die cutting, cardboard making, printing machine, right?
Yeah, and can offer you, you know, competitive prices because of that. But yeah, so when I run out of those, I want to work
with what they can do here.
Guy in Windsor, he's Halifax Folding Cartons is the company, so I'm pretty excited about that. But yeah, they all have different essential oil blends. So I don't use fragrance.
So what's an essential oil? How does that work?
Yeah, okay. Essential oils are really cool. So they're plant. They're from plants. Usually, either the...
Why are they essential? Like, what's that?
I don't know the answer to that question. Why they're called essential? That's a good question. I will research that. But how they're extracted is you often steam distillation. So very similar to, like, distilling, making vodka or gin or...
Okay.
So the plant materials kind of put in water in the base, and then it's heated up. And then the steam goes up and it condenses. And what drops down is water, but also the oils that are the natural oils
the
that are in the plant.
Oil.
Yeah,
that essential just means
just like
it's like
basic oils or something.
It's
like
the primary base level material that comes out.
Yeah.
When it, I don't know.
That makes sense.
I'm guessing it.
Yeah.
Zeus probably knows.
Zeus
but,
probably could give us
Yeah,
really.
He's nodding over there.
He knows everything.
He never turns his mic on. He's
Zeus
like, that's
everything.
Fine.
Yeah. Zeus could just have this conversation by himself, and it'd be just as interesting. But anyway, and so what comes down is water, but then the oil separates. The oil sits on top, and so what's really cool is you have a byproduct that's a hydrosol, like a rose water, if you've ever seen rose water or orange blossom water. That's the water that comes out of that distillation process, which can also be used for skin purposes or, you know, room spray or whatever. And then the oils are the essential oil. So
you don't make that yourself, do you?
No, but you know, a lot of people do. Like Rachel Robertson's got a beautiful copper still from, I think it's from Portugal. It's amazing. So she's like distilling things
she
grows.
That's a whole other, you know, I really like the idea of finding an expert in a field and hiring them.
Yeah.
Or working with them.
Yeah.
Just to see, you know, if you do it all in-house, it's great. But then there's a guy out there going, I learned these great skills. I really can help. And let's move the economy around.
Yeah,
I think
totally.
That's really cool. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. It would be neat to try. But it's also very time consuming. You sit with it. You have to keep the heat on. And you know, it's dripping out, right?
Sure.
It's not pouring out. So it's a slow. I know.
Can you imagine your very first time where you just like, that's what you're doing that evening?
Yeah.
You're just going to eat popcorn and watch it drip?
Yeah.
You know, just,
yeah. Sounds pretty nice,
it's
actually.
It's like watching the progress bar when you're...
Yeah, loading something.
Yeah.
Or, like, dial up. But, she does that. So that's super cool. I would... and she's got some beautiful products that she does through distillation. So, yeah, essential oils. Different from fragrance. Synthetic fragrance are, like, created in labs. And what's interesting about fragrance is that you don't have to disclose what's in them. So you can have any number of ingredients... that aren't listed. It would just be on a package. It will just say fragrance. You don't know what's like in it.
Flavor.
Yeah. Kind of. Yeah. Right. So, so that's why I like essential oils. And also people have a lot of allergies and skin irritations to fragrance. Less so to essential oils. About 2% of people do have skin issues with essential oils too.
I didn't realize that there was a difference. I mean, 2%, that's significant for the 2%.
Yeah.
But how big a divergence is there? Like, can someone who has, how many people who have trouble with, medicinal fragment or fragrance, you know, lab scents are okay with your product?
I don't know the number, but most. So many people.
Isn't that interesting? Yeah. What are they doing wrong? I mean, like, I guess they can't easily, duplicate what comes out of a flower.
You know? Well, it costs a lot more. So, I mean, it's cheaper to create it.
I want to tell you a neat story. This is a little sideways, but Ariel, who runs the cafe here, when she was developing some of her products, she was like, dude, I'm using margarine instead of butter. And I was like, at the time, researching healthy products, like, but think of the people, it's not a good product. It's made out of this, like, it's not vegetable oil. They do stuff to it. It's use real butter. Yeah. Goes, Mark, a block of butter is $4 to $5.
Yeah.
A block of margarine is 79 cents. Mm. Like, I'm either going to make money or lose money. Right. Like, I said, it was this real moral crisis.
Yeah.
So what we did, and she was into it too. I didn't have to push hard at all, but she was just like, oh, this sucks. We made two trays of muffins, like her beautiful berry muffins, one using butter and one using margarine.
Okay.
Just did a taste test.
Yeah.
And it wasn't sort of a suddenly, I think, no, one of them burned on the way down. It felt like, this has like, the component that's making me burn is like something that goes into a car. It's like an automotive fluid. It tasted like a muffin. It was good, but it was caustic. And then the butter one, it was the exact opposite. It felt like eating something that was good for you.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, it's cool smooth. I don't feel like it's hurting me. I feel like my body's smiling. And she's like, well, that's it. I can't sell, And so everything's been butter ever since. Right.
Right.
And she just prices it accordingly and was able to make money. Right.
But and that's what it is. I mean, it will be reflected in the cost. But
you're making a product
that
is probably reflective of that experience, I mean, if you're using soap that's using, oh, it smells nice, but why is my skin red? I'll just suck it up and literally suck up the poisons and just, to help corporate North America make the next step, as opposed to something that's like, oh, thank you.
Yeah. And your skin, like, the difference, right? But some people don't. If you've grown up using,
some people can absorb more bullshit than others, and they don't necessarily feel. They don't know they feel like crap.
Right. Until you don't. Right.
Yeah.
It's like when you cut out alcohol or you cut out sugar, and you're like, wow, I feel really good.
Yes.
I didn't realize I wasn't feeling good. But it's kind of similar, I think, because a lot of people, like, if you get soaps, like commercially made soaps that are mostly detergent based, so they're like really harsh surfactants. People just think that, dry skin in the winter, flaky, itchy skin is normal, but it's not. And it doesn't have to be, right? So like when you use a soap that actually nourishes your skin, it's such a difference. You can't go back. Like, the difference, and then you're willing to pay for something that's quality because you feel good using it.
And it's not that much more expensive. I mean, it's like, what are these, like $5 to $10 each?
They're $9.25.
Okay.
On the higher end.
Well,
no,
but that's a valid price.
Yeah.
Versus like, you can get a bar of soap for 80 cents.
Sure.
But your skin's going to come off.
You're going to melt.
And these are beautiful and they smell great.
There's like an experiential thing to it, right?
And I'm glad you're pricing them what they're worth.
Yeah,
so important. It's very hard for small business people to do that, right?
It's hard. Yeah.
Tell me about your experience with that. Like,
oh, man.
So you're first selling stuff in China. How were you making any money at all?
Yeah, we were, because just because we were moving a lot of them. Mm. And I can make 40 at a time, which isn't a ton, but it's not five, if you're making pottery or something like that, that's like you have a smaller number.
You're not doing that on a hot plate.
Yeah, exactly. And we also that's sort of a side note, but we didn't really have many costs of living there because it was sort of included in teaching. So for that reason, we, you know, a lot of it was like,
your
we were
factory
able to save.
Was rent
yeah.
free. That's
yeah,
great.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so it was like, lights and heat and the right. Cause it was, it, the apartment was paid for anyway. Yeah. Pricing, paying yourself what you're worth in your time is something that is a little challenging. And, but yeah, I think I've tweaked it and got it just right now that, because the other thing too is like the designs take a fair bit more time. So I'm not just like dumping it in. And
yeah.
So what it means though is I can't make, you know, I make four loaves at a time. So 40 bars. Each loaf has 10
Do you
bars.
Have people on like waiting lists? Do the or are you at that point? Yes, like we're...
That's another conversation. Okay, I'm like right. At that threshold. Yeah. I was just telling Zeus about it actually. I was like, I'm gonna need help. Oh. But anyway, so I can make 40 at a time, but I can't really make too much more than that at a time. Like when you have one color and you're just pouring it in molds and it's done, it's setting up, it's, you know, that's one thing. But when I have all these layers and these colors and details, it you only have a certain amount of time you can work with the soap before it starts to get thick. It's it's like going through a chemical reaction, and so it's thickening up. So I have a limited time like window to get all the layers in and to get it all, you know, set up properly before it starts to harden. So I can't actually make, I can't do like 20 loaves at a time or 200 or 300 bars, because by the time I get to that 30th loaf, right, it's going to be too hard to work with. So I'm in that way, I also have to count for like only being able to produce a certain amount at a time. And so that's where it is artisanal, because it's like,
wow, yeah, it really is
just small batch and handcrafted.
That's so interesting. So like inventions can matter, because if you found a way to sort of keep the soap, you know, liquid for another half hour, that would mean, you know.
So and there are ways you can do it. Like if you don't add your lye water and your oils together, if you keep them separate, then you know, you can do it, but it's tricky because I also have to add colors to those and separate the colors out, right, for all these different. So it's just really hard to do more than 40 at a time.
That's interesting.
And then you also take a risk when you start doing bigger batches, because like you said about the cheese, temperature, humidity, there's all these variables.
Have you had to go through that awful experience of like, hey, you know the one.
Yeah.
It's subpar, but you have to sell it and you're like, oh no.
Yeah, I've been really lucky. I've only had maybe two or three mishaps. One was like, I was like, oh, I'm gonna cry. I was making this loofah soap, and so the loofah's inside.
What's a loofah?
Oh, loofah's that natural vegetable sponge. Yeah, it's from it's in the cucumber family. So it's like
is this like
gourd.
A sea animal?
It's not. People often think that, but it's
looks like a sponge, right?
Yeah, it's in the cucumber family.
Oh,
it's
right
a
on.
Vine. Yeah, and it's like the fiber skeletal part of the. So when you dry it, you have this like inner portion that's left over. So it's really cool. And I make these in this tall cylinder mold, right? Uh-huh. So I put the loofahs inside, pack them in, so they're standing up on top of each other. And then I pour the soap in it. So what happened one time is that the soap was too thick. It set up too fast. When you add your essential oil, sometimes it speeds it up. So it's starting to get really thick, right? So I'm pouring it in and it's coming out in these globs, but it has to be thin enough to get into the fibers, right?
No.
To like spread out. So I was starting to panic. So these blobs are coming and I'm like, no. And I called Nate to come help me like smash it down, you know, to try to like disperse the.
Behave. You know,
and exactly. So it was like, there's soap going everywhere. And then it got so hot that it was starting to like bubble out, which can happen, kind of volcano.
Whoa.
So I was like, okay, I'll put them in the freezer. Just kind of like slow it all down, right? Which normally is fine. You can do that. And I go and put it in, and I have my rubber gloves on and this soapy, slick cylinder, and it just goes down in the freezer, and soap explodes all over the freezer, and I was like...
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so, yeah, there's always...
There's some physical comedy there. That would be a funny scene in a...
God, it's one of those things you have to just let it go, right? Like
literally.
You have a choice, yeah. There's been a few sad moments, but generally...
Elon Musk has blown up two starships, you know, like he's trying to launch rockets, and they... Okay, the idea is we're going to take it off and have it land, and they land.
Yeah.
Awfully hard.
Not in the way they want it.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
But it's like
part of it, eh?
It really is.
And it is how you learn. Like, I won't make those mistakes, or not, yeah, I'll be less likely to make those mistakes because I've learned, okay, you know, I got to keep the temperature at 55 degrees because over 65, this seems to, you know, there's all these little things you can pick up. So it is part of the process for sure. Yeah.
But this is why you price them accordingly, because like, look, I'm making 40.
Yeah.
Because if I make any more, it's not going to be as good a product, or it's like, I know my threshold perfection, and I got these expenses, got to keep the lights on. Yeah. I want to live.
Yeah.
You know, and so this is what it costs.
That's right.
Is $9 enough?
Yeah.
Is it? Yes
and no. If my plan,
because you also have to compete too, right?
Right.
You've got to be able to, like, someone's like, I'm not going to buy a $40 bar of soap. That's insane.
Well, that's right. There's like these thresholds also of what people are willing to pay for certain things. And they don't necessarily always correlate with the cost of that thing, right? So like women will spend a lot of money on specific skincare things that you think like, well, I wonder why, but it's
perception.
It's perception, right? So my plan was always that soap would be the foundation. I love making it. Everyone loves using, people love soap generally. Yeah. And it's something different.
It's such a great, it works. Yeah. Like nothing else does this.
Yeah, it's true. It's pretty neat. But then also to have a larger skincare line was always my plan. And that's where you make up for the small margins on soap.
Okay.
Right. And so you have a diversity of products.
So you've got some other stuff.
Yeah,
here.
Some other stuff, and I have lots coming. There's so many things I'm working on. But before I show you some of the other things, I want to show you the pine tar soap because I think you're gonna find it super interesting.
All right.
So okay, can you see that?
Let me move my mic in here. So
pine tar soap is something that actually someone who was buying soap for me asked for. They have some skin problems.
Pine tar soap. It's.
So it's the same base recipe as these ones. So I use olive oil, coconut oil, castor oil, and shea butter. Those are the four oils I use in all of them, and it's sort of the same basic formula. But this one has the addition of pine tar, which is, it's really cool. So it's this really gooey molasses-like product.
Is it sap? Or
no, it's not sap.
Do you have to like roast the wood or something?
You do. So it's wood, it's kind of like cooked under pressure. You can do it in your backyard with like the right cans, and you pack them with pine wood. But it's been used for thousands of years for different things. One of the things is rigging, like on sailboats to keep it protected from salt air and water. And then also on bats, it's for grip. They use it in baseball for grip on baseball bats. And then the third thing is it's been used for thousands of years for skin conditions like redness, irritation, itching, eczema, psoriasis, things like that. So it has like some solid evidence of.
What does it look like? Is it black or
it's like molasses. It's like dark, dark brown, and it is so smoky smelling. It just smells like a campfire. So here, you can smell this one. This is the same thing. I just brought you a little sample bar.
So this is a piece of, of pine tar.
Yeah, so give that a try. Don't try it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Yeah, so it's got this like really smoky, woodsy scent. There's no essential oils in it. So I've kept it really simple. And again, it's like it's primarily for helping with itching and redness and winter skin, you know. And different
it's kind of like it's sort of like plant-based wax
kind of it's a pretty amazing ingredient, so I'm working on
I've never heard of it before. It's because I was studying. I did a book all about medieval towns and how to build them, and there was all this technology that I was exploring and learning about. And some really cool things, like, you know, they didn't have plastic, so they'd take the horns from like cows, and if you boil them, they unroll. They're like a nail that grows in a they don't come out in a cone shape. And so you get this sheet of like stuff they could
like
make
a material.
Yeah, and they could make spoons and stuff out of it. And if you get like the thin part and you sand it down, you can kind of use it as a window because it lets a bit of light in. It's just like, really?
Whoa.
But I'd never heard of pine tar.
Yeah. And so it was mostly, so Finland, Sweden, most of the Scandinavian countries were where it was produced.
Lots of dry, cold air.
Yeah, exactly, right? And for ships going across the Atlantic, it was a huge industry. I think like in the 1800s, it was like one of Finland's main industries is pine tar. And still to this day, like this pine tar I get comes from, I think it's Sweden. But so it's 100% pine tar. It's also used in restoration, like protecting wood, so you dilute it with like linseed oil, and then you can paint on exteriors and wood to protect it. So it really has like you know, the, all the things it's been used for in different facets are all for protection and like sealing, right? It's kind of neat. So yeah, so that's a cool product. What else do we have? So I brought you some lotion. How are your hands? Do you have dry hands?
I've got, my hands are pretty good.
Yeah.
But, I could
I have a little sample for you to try. So you can try that one. And I have,
This one's unlabeled. You can tell me what to,
yeah. So that's the third scent. So I have three different scents. Again, just a blend of different essential oils. Okay. And so this is lotions.
This smells like girls I know. Hang on.
Yeah.
Who does that remind me of? Anyway.
It is floral. It's lavender.
The thing is, like, anyone who uses it, oh, that's who it reminds me of.
Yeah, yeah, right. It's lavender, clary sage, and ylang ylang. So it's sort of a more of a light floral.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So lotions are oils with water. And then there's ingredients called emulsifiers. So I use a gentle emulsifier that brings it all together. Because obviously oils and water don't mix.
Because I find, like, in the winter, I do get dry. I get, like, dry, flaky stuff. Yeah. And I'm just like, oh, I have to wash my face. But I don't. I'm sure there's something I'm supposed to put on there. Maybe the thyme, pine, I don't know.
Yeah.
But that's great. Cool.
Yeah, so and it soaks in
and
real
guys
well.
Just, I don't know. I'm so bad at taking care of that kind of thing.
I know, yeah.
I just don't care enough until I'm actually in the mirror going, what the heck happened to you?
How did I get rid of that?
How did I get sandblasted? I don't remember, you know. But I had a girlfriend who was just like, putting all this stuff on. I was like, what are you doing? She says, I do this every day. She says, why? She says, Mark, you say you like my skin. It's all, it takes work.
Takes
I was like,
effort.
Oh,
that's what I'm doing.
Side memory. This is not related and yet kind of is.
Yeah.
I remember like living in the toilet, right? You go in like, wow, it's always so clean.
Mm.
I guess it just, you know, anything that sort of stuck to it just naturally, eventually just where, no, someone's in there with a friggin' brush. And I didn't know this for years until I had a roommate who was like, dude, I cleaned the washroom. I was like, oh, I thought, I mean, oh, all this,
that's
wow, so many
works.
Things make sense.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I should teach people
how is
that.
Your toilet now?
Really clean.
Good. There you go.
I
learned.
Yeah.
You learned.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's true. Women do, yeah, for whatever reason, I mean...
Well, you're building a nest in a sense, right? You want to make it healthy. It's
Well, actually, I was thinking more of the skincare thing.
Oh,
like
okay.
Doing the, you know, having a routine. It's like kind of like a little ritual where you have, this, you know, you have your certain products you use.
You look amazing, by the
way.
Thanks. So it's like it pays off, right?
Oh, you know, thanks. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, it, you know, taking care of your skin is really important. Again, you can. I think you
I'm gonna pay attention to it. I'm gonna take this is on my two. Yeah. So I got these two here. Excellent. Yeah, I'm so excited. This is great.
Yeah.
Cool.
And you know, your skin's an organ, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
It does do a lot. It has a lot of different functions that it does, and it is a protective barrier. Like it's amazing.
And it can absorb chemicals.
Yeah.
Like this is one of the things it does really, really well, and we don't think about that.
That's right. Yeah. So it is important, and so you can try that. That should help. That's really great for the winter. What else? Oh yeah, I have natural deodorant too. Oh, you want to see these ones?
Yeah, what are those?
Yeah, these are bath bombs. Have you heard of bath
bombs?
I've
heard of bath bombs. I don't you know.
Bath bombs.
That seems like a lot of work. You know, you got to like prepare your
You just have to run a bath.
Yeah, that's
a lot of work, but... You got to get in it. Yeah.
There was one time like I don't know. I pulled a muscle or something like this and someone said, you know, dry. So I did a bath and I was like, this is amazing.
Yeah,
I could stay here all day. They should make books that are plastic so I can read them. Why would you ever want to get out? And then it gets cold. Like, oh.
I
want to
get out now. Yeah.
So I totally get it.
Mm.
But then you kind of, anything that requires process, like anything like that takes preparation.
Steps,
like, because I'll sort of, it's.
Not your favorite thing.
Yeah. Mm. Well, there's some things that I will put process time into that I understand at the end of it. There's the. But feeling good isn't one of those things. Mm. I want to feel good right now or I'll just tough it out.
Immediate gratification. Yeah. These are definitely like an experiential thing. So yeah, bath bombs are quite popular.
And is it fizzy?
Yeah.
Oh, so super cool.
Yeah, it's a combination. Baking soda and
nifty.
Citric acid creates the...
And this is for one bath?
Yeah. So it is like it's
Whoa.
A one-time... Yeah. So that's...
Oh my God. That's super cool. Can everyone see this?
Yeah. Show the top. There's a little bit of
some
clove in
there.
Yeah.
It's like a giant sugar cube.
Yeah.
Look how big it is.
Yeah.
And you just drop it in your bath and it fizzes
it fizzes and it lets out the essential oils. It also
has
so
nifty.
It has cocoa butter. So that's the butter in chocolate, right? That's natural. And two other oils, so it actually makes your skin feel so good after. So while you're in the bath,
I'm taking a bath, man, you're this like is nice like you're oily. Inspiring me to.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Get your skincare routine down. It'll feel so good.
Well, you know,
next time
year.
I see you, you'll just be like glowing.
Oh, it makes a difference, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Although I remember this one time I was taking care of a friend's apartment, and she had she was off in China for like a month.
Okay.
And she's like, Mark, can you feed my cats and make sure everything just live there? I was like, yeah. Okay. So I'd spent a few nights there, and. In her bathroom, she had all this extra stuff that I'm like, what are all these weird objects?
You started snooping.
Well, it was just there, right?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And one of them was like, and I remember I'd asked her about it before she left. Like, what's this? Oh, that's a volcanic stone. It's for scraping
off
a pumice
yeah.
stone, right?
Yeah.
It's for getting rid of dead skin. It's like, yeah. Oh, I think I might have.
And I have some of that.
Well, I scraped myself raw on one leg. I overdid it, and then I was like,
yeah.
And that didn't heal for a long time.
Yeah,
I was
those
like,
are strong.
You know, wow.
Yeah.
There's a way in a process.
Pumice is like, you know, people that have like thick calluses on their feet.
That's not what I was using it for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what it is for.
Good grief.
So yeah, exfoliation. That's a whole other conversation, but exfoliation can be. There's, you know, there's mild and there's extreme, and I think you did some extreme.
It's just so dumb. Anyway.
Yeah. The loofah soap is for exfoliating, but it's much more gentle.
Yeah.
The little fibers, they do have a little, but they're not scratchy, they're not sharp, but they do have a little bit of
But
grit.
I think it matters, because, like,
yeah.
I remember there's this one story in my head, I don't know how true it is, but it sticks.
Mm.
And, one of my friend's sisters had gone to somewhere in Asia, and they went to like a massage sauna,
yeah.
one of these kind of like that's what the building was set up for. And one of the things they did is they scraped their skin.
Yeah.
And they said the result was amazing, but they took off they came out with a big golf ball's worth of dead skin.
Wow.
And I was like, really?
That's a lot.
It seems like a lot.
Yeah.
But I mean, they felt like very tender and fresh, but they
right.
said it was an amazing thing. But then then part of the story was like stepping out into Beijing's atmosphere.
Oh, yeah.
It was just like, oh, I think I needed that dead skin
yeah,
to protect
right.
me from industry, you know?
Yeah. But, well, it's true because your skin cells like, so as they move up from the deepest part of your skin to the top layer, by the time they get to the top, they actually are dead and they flatten out and they get really hard, like these hard discs. They start as these plump circles, and then as they get closer to the surface and they get, you know, oxygenated, they get hard. And so it's a natural process that your skin, that happens, and then they fall off. And like most dust in our homes is
yep.
skin cells, right?
Yep.
We all know. But yeah, helping that process along a little bit is sometimes helpful, because
yeah.
sometimes it's
well, like
it
what's
off.
the condition where it happens too quickly and your skin's too dry, and it's like a guy, I knew a kid in high school had to go in for radiation, not ultraviolet treatments.
Oh wow.
So they had to try and kill the skin ahead of schedule to stop it, because his skin was perpetually
wow.
dry and flaking and sore and
oh,
crusty
man.
And that was, and so he needed these things, and when
yeah.
he got regular treatments, it balanced out and he was okay.
Yeah.
And the hope was that he would get to a point where
wow.
his body would naturally balance out.
Yeah.
Not scoliosis, that's the spine one.
Yeah.
But something, it had
yeah,
some kind of osis.
Okay.
And,
I don't know.
And I wonder if that's a diet thing, you know, or hormone stuff.
Oh, yeah, there's definitely a lot of connections between.
Do you remember growing up and everything? It's like, poor kids, man. Because, like, their body, okay, we're going to just flood you with these hormones, and it's not just sex stuff. It's like your body's growing, and all
yeah.
these weird things are your
yeah.
teeth are, meh, and it's just like you just
yeah.
look and feel really strange until you finally settle into
yeah.
your final version. You know,
yeah,
but
yeah.
getting there, you're like this. It's like you're, you know, what's inside the cocoon?
Mm.
Probably ain't pretty.
Yeah,
has
then
sits,
you get
you know?
Then you get to the age where you're like, wait a second, like when did that happen? When did
oh,
you
yeah,
know
yeah.
you start noticing things? Like, but anyway, yeah.
yeah.
Yeah,
what's
so what else we got going
bottle?
On? Oh, yeah, this is super cool. This is a face cleanser. So I don't know if
cleansing
you want. Some
greens.
People don't wash their face. Some people don't need to. I'm jealous of them. But yeah, instead of like a cream cleanser or a gel cleanser, it's powder. And
do you use water with it?
Yeah,
okay.
So you put a little bit in your hand. You add a few drops of water. Zeus knows because he takes some photos for me.
Oh, cool.
But yeah, and it becomes this like nice, light, creamy lather. So yeah, it's really neat. It's a clay-based product, but it also, so it's predominantly clay. And it also has really cool ingredients like chamomile powder and lavender powder, turmeric, a lot of these really like vitamin-rich natural powders and plant extracts. Yeah, so it's really cool. I'm pretty pumped about that product. And it's neat because you don't need a preservative or anything because there's no water in it, right?
It's dry, right?
Yeah. So so you can have it a long time and take it places. It's great for travel too, right? Because you can bring it on a plane.
Oh, this is an exciting set of products. And yeah, how many of these are currently, how many of these are like beta right now on the table?
Right, okay. So everything I've shown you is like, you know, out there and available. But these are, this is something I'm working on that's new.
Oh, okay.
Oh yeah, deodorant. So,
this is exciting.
Yeah, so natural deodorant. Yeah. Did I bring you a little mini one? Oh, wait, this one you can, so this one.
Oh, wow. Okay, so how do these work?
I brought you the sample one so you can actually like try it and feel it. So how do they work? So they're a blend of oils and powders. The powder that's really important in this is magnesium hydroxide, which is dietary magnesium, sometimes called milk of magnesia.
Okay.
She's
turning to our tech guy.
Looking at Zeus. Yeah, Zeus knows everything. So anyway, what that does, it's a pH balancing, and it's also super absorbent. So that's why it's great for absorbing sweat, right?
Like I currently use like a stone.
Yeah, yeah, it's the crystals.
It's like a magnesium crystal.
Okay, cool.
I did a lot of research going, is that, am I absorbing magnesium? Or no, it's an aluminum crystal.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, it just looks like a salt crystal.
Yeah.
It works super, super well. I hate, I'm going to use Right Guard or whatever.
Yeah.
Don't want to like diss a name. So just one of those many, many things that you turn the bottom and out comes this sort of like, I don't know, squishy stuff.
Yeah.
And they work. But I noticed, like, it's, I don't know if they deliberately designed it this way, but there's an evil quotient where it's like, if you go for a day, it smells even worse than if you don't have it because it's now changing its own structure molecularly. Yeah. And it's just like, so now you're like, you're like, I have to have this
because
you have to almost get off it like it's a drug or something.
Yeah. Well, it's, a lot of people who are transitioning off like aluminum based or antiperspirants that actually block or prevent sweating, they have a hard time transitioning to natural deodorants for that reason. So there's like suggestions that you do a detox or use clay to draw out all that, all the toxins and the blockages so that you can transition. So it is like, it's kind of like letting go.
I'd like to know more about that. I mean, the research that I did do into this crystal was that it, the molecular size doesn't absorb in, but I don't know, like, who said that?
Yeah, you know? I looked into that too. That's the, because a long time ago before I was making my own, I would use a spray that was the alum.
Okay. So it's alum or whatever.
Yeah, and it's the same thing. Like, the molecular size is big enough that they say, oh, it's not a problem, but you still wonder, right?
All the people who say that, it comes on websites with logos, you know?
Yeah. I know. And exactly. It's like, if you can find an alternative that works, then why not, right? So I'm really pumped about this because it's an awesome formula, and I am like a very picky, I mean, I've been using natural deodorant for 15 years, right? And I've been the person looking for one that consistently works, and I like this, but that part's not great. And then another issue with natural deodorants is a lot of them use baking soda, and baking soda for many people will cause irritation, like a rash.
Okay.
So formulated without it.
It's very base, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And it can throw off the pH, like the natural balance of the
bacteria.
Oh,
I have another question that I want to get into. Have you injured yourself making soap?
Have I injured myself?
Because I hear it can be very caustic at a certain
point. Yeah,
super
caustic. Right. So the key ingredient, sodium hydroxide, that's what pulls the oil and the waters together, right? You have to use it for traditional soap baking. But yeah, in its raw form, if you've seen Fight Club, you'll know.
Yes, right. That's where that knowledge came from.
Yeah, you'll know. Everyone knows. In its raw form, it'll burn your skin. So it's not like an instant, like, you know, you see your bone and it melts away. It's not like that. But you do have to be really careful because if you got it in your eye, you know, you only have a few seconds to sort of like get it rinsed out. So I do wear protective gear when I'm making it. So I have I have glasses and then a mask because the fumes can also irritate your lungs just when it's, again, only when it's active. Once you combine it with the fats, or the lipids, then it's fine. But yeah, you have to be careful.
I always found that really strange. Like, what, making soap, there's a dangerous port?
I know.
That seems really funny.
Like,
you know?
It's so natural. It's like, it might burn my skin off when I'm making it, but it's safe. But
how
it's
was
really
it even invented? Because it seems like, you know, the human race really needed soap for its entire existence.
Yeah, and toothbrushes.
Because nothing, yeah, you know, but because just nothing gets dirt off.
Yeah, it's
and
true.
And there must have been a time when, there must have been a long period of history where we didn't have soap.
Right.
And then someone came up with soap. But how do you get there? Yeah. How do you, where does lye even come from?
Right, okay, so I don't know a ton about this, but prior to soap, like the Egyptians used oils and oil cleanse. So like attracts like, right? So they would actually take really beautiful like seed oils that they'd press, cold press, and like lube up and then scrape it off. And so the oil...
Thank God for soap.
That doesn't sound great. Yeah, you don't even want to have a bath. Imagine doing that every day, like scraping the oil off yourself. But anyway, it would like pull off the grime and the dirt. And the sebum, which is like the oils your skin naturally produces, they go together, right? So when you put oil on it, it would pull everything off. So that was how they cleansed, which was like, you know, okay. And then soap, so you can make something kind of like sodium hydroxide with wood ash. So traditionally, that's how it was made. It was like using the ash from an old fire and mixing it with a fat, and it would create this sort of lumpy, clumpy, like sort of cleansing bar. Uh-huh. And then it's got refined over time. So yeah, the grandmothers used to use like wood ash to create.
The invention
lard. And, yeah, so it'd be like animal fat that they'd render off, you know.
Well, they're cooking and something drips and they go, oh, what's this stuff?
Yeah.
And then they're playing with it. And they're like, well, wait, what? Yeah. That's kind of, well, what if you, and then the smart kid in the corner is just going, well, what am I doing? But where does lye come from? Is that like a stone? I'm asking you a question.
Sodium hydroxide is, I'm not a chemist. Mm. So I don't know exactly. I know now that process of like wood ash, which is more of is potassium hydroxide. Now we use sodium hydroxide primarily. But now it's created, and sure. I don't know how they do that. I think it's like electrifying salt. I don't know. I've read
it's
it.
It's so interesting in how like back, you know, industry happens. I was talking to a buddy about this, and I was like, "How do you get to I don't know, like a portable radio or an MP3 player or a computer? You can't just start there. There's all these dependent industries,
yeah.
And each one has to go through its developmental like to get." You know, how do you make the first straight thing? How do you make a ruler? Yeah. And it's like, well,
that's true. You need another straight thing to make a straight thing.
Exactly, right? So you're kind of going, if you draw like wire or maybe frozen surfaces, that seems kind of like a mirror, you know, like you've got to have like,
crazy.
Holy
yeah,
crap.
So true. Yeah. And the salt, like turning sand into glass. What?
It's amazing. And so,
and you know, refining like, it, and then like being able to reproduce it consistently. Yeah, it's amazing.
It's remarkable.
People are amazing.
And we don't know. Like this is the thing. Like, how do you make something?
Yeah.
And you know, like, oh, I like to draw things on paper with ink, and like these are very, very old tools.
Sure.
But I'm still not 100% clear on how you make ink.
How it works. Yeah. What is ink?
How do you, it just water and like charcoal mixed together? I feel like I should try and do it just so that I, because if you're missing a base, I don't know, but we're all there. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows, you know, like except for Zeus.
Yeah, Zeus knows everything.
but it's a fun thing to sort of explore, right?
Yeah, and, it's true.
It's so possible to go through.
Soap possible. Anyway. Oh, jeez. Lame. Okay, yeah.
All right.
I have one more thing to show you. This one is not, so here, we'll move some of these out of the way. Right. The next thing I'm working on, I'm almost ready to release it. I'm just doing sort of the end stages, but yeah, so you know we were talking about exfoliation, right? Getting the dead skin cells off in your pumice experience, which wasn't pleasant. So I've been working on this face scrub. So it's for the face.
All right.
But it's really, really important that it be gentle exfoliation, right? Like you don't want to put a pumice to your face. You're going to be in trouble. So anyway, this is the physical exfoliator is rice powder. So it's rice flour, right?
It's got a greenness to it.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of grit and also beetroot powder.
That's not sand.
No, that's rice. So it's like really fine.
So you could even ingest this and not die.
I mean, you wouldn't. Yeah, you definitely wouldn't die. It wouldn't taste great.
It's not a food stuff, but
yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
You know when you get like one grain of sand in a bite of a sandwich, you're going.
It's just not cool. One. Yeah, and I wish we had a little bit of water because.
No.
A tiny bit of water. put it like a little drop. So what's neat about this is it's an oil-based product, but it has emulsifiers in it. So emulsifying wax binds the water in the oil. So it looks like oil, right? It feels like oil. But when you add some water, thank you, sir. Yes. See if I can just add like the smallest amount. I don't want to make a big mess on your table. I added too much. It's okay.
You can have a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. So no, you'll notice, see, it gets all creamy. So it's emulsifying. Oh, it's mixing nifty. In your hand.
It turns...
Isn't that cool?
That's super cool.
And even look what's happening here.
It looks like and
it's happening in the jar.
Oh, nifty.
So it's pretty neat. The benefit of that, I just love it. The benefit of that is that it rinses off. Because when you have the oils and water like emulsified, then it's not an oily mess on your skin. It actually stick to the water.
Where did you get this idea from?
Oh, well, face scrubs are pretty popular, so I just started playing around. I have a really awesome studio in my basement, so I just started like figuring out what is the best physical exfoliant.
Do you have a lab coat?
I have like a cute lab coat. Oh, more like an apron.
Okay, yeah.
But yeah, I just wanted something that that would exfoliate but be really gentle, and rice powder ended up being the best choice, I think.
Oh, man.
So, pretty pumped about that.
I love it. That's that's a very exciting product.
And it's I don't know if you smelled it. You should smell it. It's so it's pink grapefruit oil. So it's super refreshing.
Oh, that is nice.
And there's a bit of coconut oil in it. So sort of like grapefruit coconut. And then these are just variations. So that one's lavender and matcha powder. So it's a green tea lavender blend.
That one's good. I like that
one. Yeah, I like that one more. Okay, and then this one is pumpkin and papaya. So,
ooh, that's interesting.
Yeah, so it's not the scent so much. Those are the oils in it. The scents in that one are like cedar and cypress. And
it smells very, I want to say, it smells natural. Yeah. But I mean, it smells like...
kind of earthy, a little more.
Wow.
Yeah, so you like that one?
I this is my favorite one, yeah, but this is intriguing.
Yeah.
So, and it does the same thing. It turns...
Yeah. Get this off at some point.
There's a napkin.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. I got a little.
Can you add?
I got a little excited. Yeah. Okay. Let's see. Small. Too much. Here, I'll take some. If you have too much. There. We need a sink. Next time we need a sink.
Well, it is a soap. Look at that. That's amazing.
Isn't that so cool?
That is super,
it feels
super
really
cool.
Good. Can I have that too? Here we go. Here you are.
We're gonna have like the most silky hands when I'm done.
Yeah.
Oh, I think that's a really neat product.
So what was your favorite then? Was it
the pink one? The pink one? But yeah. But that one, yeah. If I was at your table, I'd be like having to decide, you know? Yeah.
Okay.
But this one is really, really nice.
And the color is, the colors are all natural. So the color is from the beetroot powder and rosehip powder. And so I'm pretty excited to get those out there.
Wow.
But the last.
Every time you come up with a product, though, your time is divided.
Oh, man.
So how many of these can you actually realistically keep in production without hiring someone?
That's the big question. That's what I'm trying to figure out right now. I think I'm at a point where I need someone to help with packing up orders and that sort of thing so that I can keep focusing on production.
Is your money situation such that you can afford to hire someone and
definitely
do
not
it?
Yeah. No, I mean, there's just a lot of costs with this startup, you know. Even though my studio is in the basement and I've really kept my costs low, as low as possible, you're paying your anything you make is just to pay your own wage, right? So as soon as you start paying someone else, it's tough. But I think I'm gonna do the government grant, so they'll
supply
the
that can work. That's I mean, that program, I haven't actually seen the results of it, but when I look at what it offers, you're like, that's great.
Yeah.
So the idea is that they'll pay the wage for 6 months or something like this.
Yeah.
And with the idea that in that time, if you work really, really hard,
you can
hire them properly.
Yeah. And that's the hope. Yeah. So I'm sort of at that, you know, there's sort of these like growth stages where...
Because you need the capital to be able to hire the person. So to make the capital, you need to increase production.
Know,
but you can't do it.
Exactly. This is the dilemma. Right. So that is
And
where
an invention. Like this is where an inventive type goes, okay, what if we were to come up with a way of just make, instead of making 40 bars, you can make 80.
Right.
Without sacrificing quality or screwing your time scheduling up. Is there a way of doing that? And that little, this paper packaging.
Yeah.
That you showed me with the V in it.
Yeah.
That's the kind of thinking, that's exactly the kind of problem solving that leads to that kind of invention. I mean, that's, anyway.
Oh, thanks.
But
you know what? That's one thing I love about having a small business is that you're constantly just problem solving.
Yeah.
Tons of little problems all the time. Like, how am I going to package this? How am I going to, how am I going to get this consistency I want? What do I need to add? What do I need to take away? It's just like constantly trying to fix things. And so it never gets boring, right?
I'm not going to hesitate to ask. I'll just ask. Do you know what? Oh, you were in China. So this is relevant.
Yeah.
What year were you born?
Oh, I am the, I'm the dragon.
You're a dragon.
Yeah.
There it is.
Are you a dragon?
No. But dragons are awesome. They thrive on exactly this kind of thing.
Cool. You know about this, eh?
Oh yeah.
Ooh.
I had a friend who studied Kung Fu, and he was doing that through Chinese masters, etc. Yeah. And he brought all this interesting knowledge. And so I learned all about that side of stuff and just how valid it is. Mm. And so, like, I was getting, she's either a monkey or is she a dragon?
Wow.
So, yeah.
Cool.
I mean, I usually I'm wrong, but just the way you carry yourself and your friend group, that says so much, because Dan is a monkey. And I believe Amanda is a dragon.
Amanda is a dragon. We were born the same year.
Yeah. And for one of the things that, like, when you're talking to some, tell me what sign am I? Am I a Gemini? Am I a Cancer? That's very hard to divine from talking to someone. You get sort of a sense, but where it's really easy to divine and not, it just, the patterns really stand out is the people you get along with tend to be complementary signs. So if you know a few people's signs, you can pretty much guess who their friends are, right?
So it's easier to go by who they surround themselves with than just by how they present
themselves.
Ease
of communication, right?
Yeah,
so the things that you value and understand that someone else values and understands
it's just going to naturally.
You're not interpreting, you're just directly communicating.
Yeah,
right?
That's so interesting.
That's so cool. And and monkeys, dragons, and rats are just designed to solve these kind of cool problems.
Oh,
and
man, that's so interesting.
It really is cool, you know. Cool. And Zeus is a monkey.
I was just going to ask, what's Zeus?
Monkey.
See?
So.
And I love Zeus. Yeah. He does love Zeus.
And I've got, I was born in the hour of the rat, so I get it.
Okay.
But I'm a dog, so that's a whole other universe of personality type. And it's a whole other thing. But
that's neat knowledge.
Most of my, like some of my favorite business people tend to be, like dragons are just, out of the 12 animals, it's the only one that's magical. Think about it, right?
That's true.
You know? And they need to be, if they're not in charge, they have to be in charge, and that's not a bad thing.
Yeah.
It's like, if they're not in charge, they literally wither and die.
Yes. It's true. It's so funny, because I am not a bossy person. I don't like the spotlight, but doing jobs has been, I give a lot, I work really hard, but like, I can't do more than a few years without starting to have that like withering feeling, like you said.
Yeah.
And I think it's just because there's things I want to change that aren't working, or they're not efficient, or they're unfair, and you can't, right? Because you don't own.
If the world stood back and let dragons be healthy, good dragons, we'd be living an awesome, like, you know, do you know anything about animated Japanese movies? Do you know Miyazaki's work?
No, I know like Spirited Away.
Yeah.
Anyway,
he's a dragon.
Okay.
And that's how that works. Like when he was young, he basically unionized Japanese animators, and they're like, I'm talking about things you don't know.
No,
this is like
cool.
A major core element of this show is like, I want to talk about comics.
Cool.
But underpaid, overworked, slave labor, sleep under your drafting board, get up early and get back to work kind of thing. And
someone else?
And you're doing it because you love art, but then the machine that makes it, it's very, very hard living. And Miyazaki was like,
isn't working. Yeah.
And he started a union in like, the 60s or 70s, something like this. And became a director and just had this vision and just knew how to. And so he's got like this, he's built an empire where no one questions him, and why would they?
Right.
So he's just got legions of strong, loyal followers. I'm probably misrepresenting him, but the product is like when, like, that's a healthy dragon who's built the proper empire.
That's right. Yeah.
So the kind of employees that you'd need would have to be subservient and really skilled and happy in that role. And that's
right.
And there are people
And there are people, that are really happy just to show up and do what they're told and to get joy out of just like, that's really interesting. I'll have to do a little more research, because when I was in China, I didn't spend a lot of time learning about the animals. But I do know that, you know, the dragon's lucky, and Chinese parents want their children to be born in a dragon year.
Is that right?
So the dragon years, there's always a spike in birth rates because everyone tries for the...
That makes sense, I
guess. Yeah, yeah, because we just finished a dragon year, didn't we, 2 years ago?
Year 2000 was a dragon year. That was one of the big deals with it. And so every 12 years, 2012, and I guess we just came out of a rat year. Actually.
Oh, okay.
Which is good. That works because it's basically it works in trines. Because if you plot the signs in a circle and make a triangle and just click it, each one that's like whatever number of degrees across from you, that's your best friend. Like, so for you, monkeys and rats and dragons just understand and work really, really well together. Do you know what your partner is? I don't want to. Sometimes
he's not. Well, he's 1985, so he's a. What's right now? What's the year right now? Is it rat? No. What's
rat ox.
He's an ox. Yeah, he's like the What does that mean?
Well, I mean, like, this is why I always what's your partner? Oh, wait, I shouldn't have asked that, because if it's not...
That's not going to work.
The thing is, there are so many elements to it, because, like, there's the year, the month, and the hour. Those are three things that you can measure, and they can really balance one another out.
Yeah.
And I've been in relationships where it should be a perfect thing, and you can see that it is, but you're going, you almost need a little friction. You can't have... If you're perpetually validated, you don't grow.
That's true. You stagnate if you're never being challenged.
And you're super aware of, like, oh, I don't want to bring that up. And so you get really good at dancing around your flaws, and it can be really great. But part of it's good to push a little bit.
Yeah, you do need a bit of tension. Tension makes change, I guess.
And if his hour or month is complimentary to you, then he can like, oh, I understand exactly where you're coming from on an emotional level or whatever, you know. So there's a lot of variances, but that's just another whole level of interest
we'll
for me.
We'll have to do that next time.
The animals. So how long have we been at it, Zeus?
1 hour and 35 minutes.
Okay. Sweet. We're kind of getting to the point where it's getting cold in here.
Yeah, it is getting cold in here. I was just starting to feel that.
Yeah, we have a heater going. We have like two options. Okay. We can have gentle heat or heat that invades the audio sphere, right? So
interesting.
So we like to heat it up a bit before guests come. Anyways, I think that was really cool.
Cool.
And there's a couple things we have to cover. It's like, if people want to get your products, how do we do that?
Great. Okay, so I sell online through my website, and
we'll have a link for that for sure.
Perfect. Yeah. So it's Verve Skin. I didn't really tell you about the Verve, but anyway. it's a play off my name and off the word Verve that has an E, which is enthusiasm and doing things with, you know, excitement. And so it's kind of a play off that. Anyway, verveskin.ca. And then I have this pickup box outside my house in New Minas. It's pretty basic, but
it's Nova Scotian businessman. It does work, you know. Like,
people can come by at their convenience, and they, you know, it's kind of nice. So there's that option for if you want all of the products like that are available. You can go through my website, but there are some local retailers carrying it. So EOS has some products, Anatolia in New Minas.
Do you have like package deals? Like, I want to get one of everything and maybe get a little bit of a discount if I get like $100 worth of stuff or.
Yeah. I have a few like gift boxes, but bundles or something. I'm going to start
next holiday season.
I need to take some photos for me. He's on my to-do list, but yeah, for sure. Like having, you know, five, you'd have a bundle.
That's
discount.
Great.
So for sure, I'm working
that
on
first little loaf of all these different soaps here.
Yeah, and
that looks super cool, right?
Yeah, right. See all the different colors, and the tops are kind of neat because they all have a little bit of variation.
Well, one of the nice things about your product too is that it gets used up.
Right.
And so, like when I sold comics at the farmer's market, they're perpetual; they last forever, or as long as paper lasts, which isn't forever, but long enough, you know.
Yeah.
And so you wouldn't get repeat customers.
Yeah.
And that, so I would go to a market and sort of like drain it of its resources and everyone's, and then have to move to the next one.
Right, because
like a virus.
You saturated. Yeah,
yeah,
it's
exactly.
True. Yeah.
But, and that's how books work.
Sure.
But here, you can literally build up a clientele, right?
Yeah, that's right. And what's awesome about it is like soap is sort of the gateway drug, as I like to call it. But, you know, you try it and you're like, wow, I really love this product. It feels good. It smells good. You start to build that trust with the
relationship.
Yeah, the relationship. And then from there, they might want to try something else. And that's how you can, you know, get people interested in the full range of products is through soap, which is like, you know, at a price point that most people can start at. So, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, well.
Cool. It was a pleasure.
Yeah, Allie, thank you so much for coming by. Yeah, Allie Verve, everybody.
Yeah.
And we're going to call that a show. So hit like and subscribe if you like this kind of content. I want to get more guests on like Allie and promote more small businesses. If you have a small business in the Valley and you'd like to be on the show, please reach out. My email and such is linked somewhere. And that's it for this episode. Hope you all have a great evening or day wherever you are. Love you all. Take care. And we're out.